Are you a no-code consultant, but not quite sure what the best way for you to package your services is? You are in luck because in this video, we're gonna be breaking down the three major ways that no-code consultants can package their services so that by the end, you know which of these choices is best for you and your business. So if that's of interest, stick around and let's get into it. Welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Gareth. I'm the owner at Gap Consulting, a company that we've grown over the last several years to be a successful no-code consulting firm in our niche. But this particular video is being brought to you by my second brand, Built to Scale. Built to Scale is all about helping you follow in the footsteps of what we created at Gap Consulting so that you can achieve financial freedom, work from anywhere, and serve your target customers, your niche market, so that you can help them get the skills they need in place with the software they're using. If you are new to no-code consulting or just considering becoming a no-code consultant, check out my free training. You can grab that at built2scale.io. There is a 5-day challenge on that site that is going to walk you through step by step the different key fundamental pieces of setting up your first $1,000 online. This is going to help you carve out your niche and make contact with your first few clients so that you can start earning. So grab that training so you can be on your way to earning your first $1,000 as a consultant online. But without further ado, let's hop into the heart of this video. We've got to talk about the three key different ways that you could set up services for a consulting business. Now, I want to say that at the end of this video, I will be telling you which of these I think is best for my business. Of course, that's not necessarily the same for you. So be sure to stick around until the end to hear, you know, my journey as I've kind of transitioned through these various different models for consulting. Now, the first business model that you might use to set up your no-code consulting services is called the fixed scope model. Now, using a fixed scope, essentially this means that you're gonna go in and bid on a project from start to finish, giving them a finite dollar amount that will encompass all of the work for that project. This is a very popular idea for a number of reasons, but there are also some hangups, as is true with any model, some pros and some cons for you to consider. Now, one of the biggest pros of the fixed scope model is that you can charge a higher price. Because of the fact that you're not actually telling the client upfront how many hours you're going to be committing to something, you can just bid a certain amount of money, and whatever that cost is that's incurred by the client, you don't have to log or track your time against that project, at least not in a client-facing way. The client will never ask you, if you're running on a fixed scope, how long something took, because it's not part of the agreement. For you, this means that you could actually charge a higher dollar amount for the amount of hours that you're contributing on that project. You might estimate that a project would take 100 hours, and if your billable rate is normally at 150 or 200 an hour, you can raise that substantially when putting together your bid for the fixed scope. Instead, take a $300 an hour rate and multiply that by your 100 hours estimated for this project. In this way, you wind up receiving a lot more revenue for fewer hours worked, but that only holds true if your estimate is on point. And I think that you'll learn over time that it's usually very difficult to get these estimates very precise. Now, another pro here is that fixed scope projects are a lot easier for the customer to understand and compare. You're coming in as a consultant saying, X dollars is what this whole thing is gonna cost, and it's simple for your client to say, okay, well, I can compare that to maybe other offers if I'm shopping around, or I can just determine if that's in my budget or not. A fixed scope is very clearly defined, and the simplicity of it makes it really easy for everyone to get on the same page really quickly. Now, a big negative on the fixed scope is that they are subject to what is called scope creep. Scope creep is what happens when you're working with a client and unforeseen things kind of creep out of the woodwork. You didn't know that there were going to be certain problems because, frankly, you don't find out a lot of the things until you're halfway into the project. Scope creep is a real problem for fixed scope bids because you have no way to guard or protect against them. So you might have thought that a project would only take 100 hours, but when you're halfway into the project, you come to find out that you're going to need to do an additional 50 hours worth of work on a project. that is really going to eat against your budget. Again, you could charge higher dollar amounts on your hourly effective rate, but at the end of the day, you might wind up eating a lot of the profits that you would have otherwise had in this project because they fall victim to scope creep, meaning you have to put in a lot more time than you originally estimated. Now, the other big drawback of a fixed scope bid is the fact that you have to do all the work up front to determine what the scope of the project is. And very often you're doing that work for free just so that you can bid on the project. We're talking hours and hours of effort that you're putting into a project up front, and you're not even getting paid by the client yet. You don't even have a signed agreement. So these are the reasons that the fixed scope might work or might not work. What I want you to consider is, does it work for your particular consulting practice? Is it the software that you're working with, the clients that you're working with? Is there a match there? Is it gonna cause problems, the ones that I highlighted, or is your process relatively streamlined where you can have the same fixed scope every time, nail it really easily, time and time again? The answer to that question really relies on you and the way you've structured your business and also where you are in your growth stage. Let's now move on to the second option for business model for no-code consulting, and that is the time and materials model. Time and materials basically means that you form an agreement with a client that you will be charging them based on the effort that you put in. So for example, you might say to a client that we think this is a 100 hours project. 100 hours worth of effort here, but we won't know for sure until we're really into it. We will agree to a certain rate per hour. So we might say for $200 an hour, we are willing to work on this project and you can buy those hours in blocks of time. For example, you might say you can pay for 40 hours worth at a time until the project is done. Now, a huge plus for this model is that it allows your client to stop whenever. The client is under no obligation with you to create the entire project. So after the 40 hours, that little first bucket of time they bought, if they didn't get a good result, they can leave and go somewhere else. This is a big plus for your clients, maybe not for you as a consultant, but it will help you sell these engagements because when you're having the sales conversations with your prospective clients, you can point out to them that if they're unhappy with their work at any point along their journey, that they can stop and they don't need to renew for any additional time. However, on the flip side, the drawback to this particular model is that it's incredibly resource planning heavy. You have got to really dial in your system in order to make sure that you have available resources for the amount of time that you promise to your clients. It can be incredibly difficult if you're just starting out as a consultant to use this model. So generally speaking, it's not the one that I recommend when people are just starting their consulting practice, but over time, as you build your team and you start to have additional resources at your disposal, it starts to become the preferred model because you are able to flex with that resource availability in a much easier way. This now takes us to the third and final model that we're considering in this video, and that has to do with having a retainer for hours. So this is very similar to the time and materials model, but there's a key distinct difference here where the retainer is essentially on a schedule. And so the retainer idea is to say, hey, once a month, I am going to bill you for 40 hours worth of effort, or whatever that amount of time is. Now, the other key difference between retainer and some of the other models is retainer is usually on a use it or lose it type of system, meaning I'm giving you 40 hours to use in a month. If you don't use them, client, that's it. I'm still gonna collect the money on that retainer and you're not gonna have seen anything for it. So if you only use 10 of the hours, you paid a whole heck of a lot for those 10 hours. But the advantage for the customer, not for the consultant, but from the customer's perspective is the fact that they're generally paying less for the retainer of hours. And the reason for this is you are promising to make those hours available, but they don't always get used. And so of course, from the client's perspective, they need some incentive in order to want to agree to that. So the way you incentivize them for a retainer is to say, well, my hourly rate is normally $200 an hour, but for a retainer, maybe I will sell those hours to you at $150 an hour or $125 an hour. So that if you use them all, you're getting a great deal. If you don't use them all, I'm getting a great deal as a consultant. So there's a little bit of give and take when you're negotiating that contract so that both parties are getting something from that agreement. Now, in my experience, when we've tried to use a retainer model, it wound up being that we used all of the time. So I wouldn't expect that you're gonna see a lot of unused hours. So do take that into consideration when setting up your contract. Now, I've already talked to a negative for this particular approach, but a positive for this approach is that you can really set your watch to your recurring revenue. When you establish a contract with a new client for a retainer, you know, for a certain amount of time at least, they will be on that contract and you know you have that income coming in. This makes it easy for you to grow and scale your business because you already know you have a certain amount of money that you can expect every month, and that makes it a lot easier when you're trying to hire new folks to join your team. Because as you're growing and scaling a business, if you don't have recurring revenue, it can be pretty tricky if you don't know where your next dollar is coming from. So those are the models that you can consider when you're setting up your services as a no-code consultant. But as I promised at the beginning, I wanna walk you through the journey, the transition that we took here at Gap Consulting. Again, this might not be perfect for everybody, and I want you to consider for yourself, what software are you consulting in? And also, what does your typical project engagement look like? If the fixed scope is relatively similar every time, then you might be more drawn to the fixed scope approach. However, if like Gap Consulting, you're doing a different custom project every time, well then fixed scope is gonna be pretty difficult. So take all that into consideration when you evaluate your own process. But for us, this is what our own journey looked like. We started with the fixed scope approach, as I kind of alluded to earlier. We started with the fixed scope and just said, hey, for X amount of dollars, here is what we offer. We can take a project from here to here, usually from start to finish, and this is what it's gonna cost. Now, originally, that fixed scope amount was the same for every client we worked with. And that, of course, became a problem pretty quickly, where we realized, oh man, we're doing a lot more work on this project, not as much work on this project. And eventually, after we'd grown our team and added a few members, we realized that the fixed scope approach really didn't suit our specific consulting strategy. At that point, we moved over to a time and materials basis. And since we made that change, we've just seen exponential growth over that time. Time and materials was a lot easier for us to manage, but it did require that we put a lot of effort in upfront in building our own resource management system. So we have to manage all of the availability for our various consultants and our clients and match all that together. And that got really cumbersome. So of course, we had to put a lot of effort upfront into building that, as I mentioned. But once it was up and running, then this became a great system for us because we could just easily onboard new folks to the team and get them set up in the system. And so we only had to have that headache that one time. So hopefully our journey can help inspire and guide you on yours. But if nothing else, at least you took away from this video the three different key models to consider. So do give this some thought and see if there's one that I left out. Definitely drop me a comment below because I'm always open to new ideas. If you want to see more videos like this one, be sure you've subscribed to this channel. That's it for this video. In the meantime, keep on building.